Blackstone Publishing presents The Cursed Towers by Kate Forsyth. This book is read by Elle Newlands. For my nonny, Joy Mackenzie Wood. Thou shall not suffer a sorceress to live. Exodus, chapter 22, verse 18. If any person or persons shall consult, covenant with, entertain, employ, feed or reward any evil or wicked spirit for any intent or purpose, or take up any dead man, woman or child, out of their grave, or any other place where the dead body resteth, to be employed or used in any manner of witchcraft, sorcery, charm or enchantment, whereby any person shall be killed, destroyed, wasted, consumed, pined or lamed in his or her body, every such offender shall suffer death. An act against conjuration, witchcraft, and dealing with evil and wicked spirits. A statute made in the first year of the reign of King James I, 1603. The Shining City. Snow drifted down from the darkening sky, mantling the horses' manes. Leilanth huddled into the rough blanket. She hated winter. Ordinarily, she would have found a sheltered valley some weeks ago, with rich dark soil in which to dig her roots. There she would have dreamed the winter away, her sap quiescent, the winter storms shaking her boughs, but barely penetrating her slumbering senses. Only when the snow had melted, and her sap quickened, new buds swelling along her twigs, would she have stirred and stretched and opened her long eyes, smelling the sharp spring wind. Only then would she have shaken the earth from her roots and taken her first trembling steps after the long winter rest. Instead, the tree shifter was perched on the hard wooden bench of Gwillem the Ugly's caravan, trying to keep her balance, as the cart lurched over the ruts of the dirt road. Her twiggy hair was hidden beneath a plaid, and her broad, gnarled feet were wrapped in sheepskins. Leilanth was taking no risks despite the success of the Samhain Rebellion, which had restored the Coven of Witches. Already they had encountered trouble along the road, her uncanny green eyes arousing suspicion among crofters whose hatred of fairies had been encouraged for 16 long years. Enid Silverthroat's brightly painted caravan swayed ahead of them, while behind rattled her son Morel the Fire Eater's caravan, and an old canvas-covered wagon driven by a slim young man with a crimson velvet cap and very bright black eyes. Leilanth turned to gaze back at him, clenching her jaw a little when she saw the pretty blonde who sat beside him, laughing at one of his jokes. Leilanth would much rather have been sitting beside Dida the Juggler, singing and laughing, than beside the taciturn Gwillem. Somehow Gillian Caslin always managed to get there first, however, and Leilanth was too shy to insist on having her turn. Huddled under the meagre shelter of the canvas were a cluster of children, the youngest only 9, and a young fair-haired woman in the final months of pregnancy. She was wee-faced, and her eyes were closed, her hand gripping the side of the wagon, as she tried to brace herself against its lurch and sway. One of the young men walking beside the wagon turned often to glance up at her, his face creased with anxiety, and once he reached up to touch her in reassurance. Ian McFagan and Elfrida Nickheald had not been married very long, and although theirs had been a marriage of convenience, it had soon blossomed into love. Leilanth clung to the sideboard as the mare's hooves slipped on a patch of ice, causing the caravan to slide sideways. Gwillem the Ugly gripped the reins tighter, urging the mare on. Ahead, Enet's caravan was almost invisible in the snowy dusk, and Gwillem said anxiously,
"We had best find somewhere to camp soon, for it'll be another bitter night by the looks of it."
The old jongleur did not pull her caravan over, however, not even when they passed a field with running water, and a tall stand of trees where they might have sheltered. They began to see the occasional cottage, orange warmth glinting through the shutters. Then lights pricked the gloom ahead. Gently, Gwilym shook Leilanth, who had dozed off to sleep. She woke with a start, straightening hurriedly and rubbing her eyes with one hand.
"There's a town ahead, thank Aya," Gwilym said. "Hot stew and soft beds for us tonight. Keep your plaid over your head, there's a good lass. We dinna want to be chased out of town again, that be for sure."
Leilanth gave a shudder and rubbed the bruise on her cheekbone where she had been hit by a stone at a village a few days earlier. She pulled the plaid close about her face as they drove over the bridge and into the town square, the wheels of the caravans rattling loudly against the cobblestones. Dida handed the reins of the great cart horse to Ian and leapt down from the wagon, his guitar in hand. He began to strum it melodiously while his father shouted,
"Come watch the jongleurs sing for ye and play. Let us chase the winter miseries away. We'll sing for ye tunes both wistful and gay, amuse ye, enthrall ye, and lead ye astray."
The doors of the Glenmorvan Inn swung open, and curious faces peered out. Children tumbled out of the cottages, followed by their bright-eyed mothers, while the few merchants still packing up their stalls glanced up in interest. The innkeeper beckoned the jongleurs in, with a broad grin splitting his bearded face.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.